of course, this is not something that you haven't heard or seen. It's just that, you know, I felt that I should take this opportunity to say in front of people how extremely bold and courageous she and her husband have been, especially during the last in the last couple of years. We've seen how they've been standing up and speaking up. So I would really like to congratulate her before we actually begin this session. Of course, along with her husband, I consider them a flamboyant couple, a power couple in the corridors of Lutyens' Delhi. But that is only secondary to the actual work that they do. There are a lot of things that came to my mind when I was asked to interview her, but I was asked to specifically talk about this book which was released recently. Let me begin, Sagarika, with the most obvious question. The most obvious question, which I'm sure you've been asked so many times since the release of this book that you have an answer rehearsed for this. Why Indira Gandhi? I mean, there's so much written about her already. So what is it that made you feel that you could add to this body of knowledge that is already available?
First of all, thank you so much, Sunita, for that wonderful introduction, and thank you so much to the Hyderabad Literary Festival for inviting me. It's a delight to be here. It's a delight to be in your wonderful city where the weather is really gorgeous. And it's also great to be in the Hyderabad Public School, which I believe is an iconic institution here in Hyderabad, with lots of eminent people having graduated from the school. So I'm very privileged to be here. I'm on a literary tourism journey these days. I'm going from literary fest to literary fest. I went to the Jaipur Literary Fest, then to the Calcutta Literary Fest, and now here I am in Hyderabad. But this certainly has a special feel, and I'm delighted to be here. So thank you very much. Why Indira Gandhi? Well, basically because last year, 2017, when the book came out, was her 100th year. It was 100 years of Indira Gandhi. If Indira Gandhi had been alive, she would have been 100 years old. And so the publisher actually approached me to write the book to commemorate 100 years of Indira Gandhi. And I, as a political journalist, was very interested in writing about Indira Gandhi, you know, because to me, Indira Gandhi, in a way, is still ruling India. Her politics is still ruling India. You know, any leader today who wants to be supremo in the government, supremo in the party, collide with institutions, collide with the press, collide with the media, collide with the judiciary, reach across the heads of the party and embrace voters in a direct populist embrace, is playing by the Indira Gandhi playbook. She was Independent India's first personality cult, as I call her. The you know, as I've spoken about her often, she was the dabang in a khadi sari, and she, as far as politics was concerned, she was James Bond. She felt she had a license to kill. But a lot of politicians today, whether it's a Mamata Banerjee, Nitish Kumar, Jayalalitha, you know, anyone who is a supremo and believes in the supremo cult, Mr. Narendra Modi, is following the Indira Gandhi playbook. She was the first supremo. She was the first personality cult in that sense. Nehru was not like that. Nehru was very much part of a movement and very much a constitutional democrat, but she believed in the politics of personality. She believed in the politics of singularity, and the party was only number 10. She was number 1 to number 10. The party was number 11. So Indira Gandhi's brand of politics, I believe, is very much alive today. The Indirafication of Indian politics, I believe, is very, very live and real today, which is why, as a political journalist, I was interested in looking at the kind of politics she played, because if you look at so many politicians today, they're all copying her.
That's true.
I wish her grandson would copy her.
That's a good one.
He may learn a thing or two.
And I must tell you that I am not a big fan of non-fiction, but I found this book really very interesting and racy to read. And it was very readable, though biographies can be dull. Of course, her life wasn't dull, so that helped, I'm sure, in a great way. I was a little interested in the way you've narrated the whole thing. you've interspersed it with letters. I don't want to play spoiler here. I don't want to tell you what is exactly in the book, but let me tell you that it's a very interesting way of narration. In between, she has interspersed it with letters to addressed to Mrs. Gandhi, or rather Mrs. Gandhi's ghost. So what gave you the idea and what was the purpose of doing that?
Well, this relates to your earlier question, you know, that why another book and what's different in your book. Mm. So, you know, there are 120 biographies of Indira Gandhi. I read 80. Oh. So I was asking myself, what can I do that will be different? You know, so I thought maybe if I made it an interrogation of Indira Gandhi, and as a journalist, I would love to interview Indira Gandhi, but of course she's no longer there. So I thought I would interview her ghost and sort of write letters to a ghostly Indira Gandhi, asking her the questions that I've always wanted to ask her. So I thought that might make it interesting for the reader and make the book a little different from the rest of the 120 biographies that exist.
You know, how difficult was it to write about this person who was multidimensional, and you couldn't put her into any particular slot? She was a bundle of paradoxes. You know, I think the whole book, I think the theme is how you try to bring together these, make sense of these paradoxes.
Yeah, absolutely. A very complicated person who had very complicated relationships. You know, one of her biographers wrote, and I've quoted in the book, that about her husband Firoz Gandhi, that she didn't like Firoz Gandhi, but she loved him. In fact, that's the that sums up her character to me in a way. She loved what she didn't like. That was the complexity of Indira Gandhi, someone who actually loved what she didn't like. She said she loved Indian democracy, but she was no Democrat and she didn't quite like Indian democracy. She said she loved the men in her family, Sanjay Gandhi, Rajiv Gandhi, Jawaharlal Nehru, but she had a lot of issues with them and she didn't quite like them often. She said she loved Indian politics, but she didn't like Indian politics and she manipulated politicians very, very cleverly. She said she loved the Indian free press, but she didn't like journalists at all. And she kept them at bay. In fact, of course, she put 253 journalists in jail. So Indira Gandhi was the person who loved what she didn't like.
Yeah, she could be kind and compassionate at the same time, could be ruthless.
Yes, she lived in black and white. She was good, she was bad, she was angelic, she was wicked. She was a Democrat, she was not a she was a dictator, she was a man and a woman, she was both feminine and masculine. She never thought of herself, in fact, as a woman. You know, she often thought of herself as a sort of biform human being, both man and woman. In fact, she often used to say that I'm like my grandfather, I'm a biform human being, both man and woman. Her saris. You know, I started wearing lots of saris after I started writing about Indira Gandhi, because she really was an aficionado of saris. Indira Gandhi, a whole book could be written on her saris, you know.
True.
The handlooms, the georgettes, the zaris. In fact, there's a very interesting story that I have in the book where
Nehru talks about her.
Yes, and where, you know, she's riding in an open jeep in rural West Bengal. And she's waving to the crowd. You know, in those days, leaders used to ride on open jeeps. There was no security. And behind her was sitting the head of intelligence, a gentleman called J.P. Dutt. And she was riding in this open jeep and waving to the crowd. And suddenly she said, Mr. Dutt, what kind of sari do you think that young girl there is wearing? So the intelligence official got all confused and said, Madam, I don't know. Must be some silk sari. I think some silk sari. She said, it is not a silk sari, Mr. Dutt. It's a handloom sari from Coimbatore. What kind of intelligence are you gathering? So that was Indira Gandhi for you.
Going by what, how you have spoken up in the last couple of years against the government, you've been really critical and all that. So I expected, personally, before I started reading the book, I expected you to go soft on Indira Gandhi. I thought you would show, because like you just said, she's got positives and negatives. So I thought you would lay more stress on the positive side, but I didn't see that.
No,
happening in that.
Pretty scathing, actually.
Yes.
Well, you know, I consider myself a journalist. As somebody said, are you a on Twitter, I keep getting called Kongi, Liptard, you know, Desh Drohi, Pakistani agent. And I keep saying, you know, I am neither communist, nor socialist, nor capitalist, nor activist, nor nationalist. I am only journalist. So that's the only ist I am. So okay. I have, you know, I followed too many netas to be a cheerleader of any neta. So when I was commissioned to do this book, I told the publisher that, listen, I'm not going to write any rah-rah cheerleading account of Indira Gandhi. So in fact, I've been quite scathing about her politics.
Yeah, I can say that.
while I disapproved of her politics, I found her personality quite seductive. Mm. And that was what I was drawn to.
I'm sure you had a tough time.
Yes, I had a tough time wrestling with that.
So you must have read, like you said, you read huge amount, you read about 80 of her books written on her. So what is it that you discovered that you didn't already know about her?
Well, a lot of little details, you know, because the big political details we all know. I discovered she was extremely sporty. Okay. Did anybody here know that Indira Gandhi was an expert skier? She could ski. She could swim very well. She was an effective horse rider. She was the only prime minister, I think, who was the head of a bird watching society. I think today prime ministers watch different kinds of birds. But she actually used to watch birds, you know, as in real birds, feathered birds. She was head of a bird watching society. She was extremely outdoorsy and capable of tremendous physical stamina. You know, when a British journalist asked her, how are you different from other Indian politicians? She said, sheer physical stamina. I can outrun and outwalk all of them. So, you know, when she was 60 years old, as you know, she rode on an elephant and went to Belchi without a howdah. She rode barebacked on an elephant. So she was capable of tremendous physical endurance. And I think I discovered a person of a wide range of interests. You know, when she was a great, one of her hobbies was watching insects. Oh. And so on her table, she had a butterfly and a cockroach. It was like, ouch. So, you know, she used to love insects. She used to love wildlife. She was a great naturalist, a very outdoorsy person. And Menaka Gandhi, you know, who I spoke to, said she actually learned her love of animals and her love of wildlife from her mother-in-law.
In fact, the book is interspersed with several such anecdotes and lovely little stories and a lot of quotations also, because of the constraints of time, I haven't marked, and I have marked them for myself, but I can't read them out. But one thing I'd like to mention here, one person who really stood out for me in the entire book was someone that I had heard spoken of very vaguely during her time, but you give him a very prominent position, and that is Mr. P.N. Haksar.
Yes.
So you say that he was behind all the big moves in her lifetime, yes. That is the bank nationalization, where it's abolition of privy purses, and he was also the man behind the during the war, which we all give her credit for, the Bangladesh Liberation War.
Yeah, I mean, P.N. Haksar, that's very said, because that's exactly what I did want to convey, that in fact, we often don't realize the role of Mr. P.N. Haksar. I believe a new book is being written on him. But he was the man who was really the architect of the split in the Congress, Garibi Hatao, bank nationalization, and of course, the Bangladesh War. I mean, the Bangladesh War left me gasping. It really left me gasping, because all of us who've read about the Bangladesh War, but when you research it in detail, you know, the sheer raw courage of Indira Gandhi, who won the most decisive military victory that any prime minister has ever won in the history of India. 10 million refugees were pouring into India. The whole world turned its back on India. Europe turned its back on India. England turned its back on India. China was allied with Pakistan. The United States was allied with Pakistan. She went to the United States to ask for help. Nixon called her a bitch. He called her a witch. He said, let's not slobber over the old witch. He said, Indians are repulsive people. Why do they breed? When the millions are coming in, she should shoot them at the border. Nixon hated Indira Gandhi. You know, the newly released Kissinger papers. Shocking what he said about Indira Gandhi. And their meeting in Washington was what Gary J. Bass calls a cathartic brawl. But it was interesting how she snubbed Nixon after that, you know, because after this terrible summit where Nixon had been hostile to her and nasty to her, and she had hated him, and Kissinger said she treated him with an elegant condescension he found unbearable. And you know, they come out of the meeting, and then there's the official dinner, the big official dinner that takes place. And there's a huge table, a U-shaped table, and she's sitting at the head of the table, and next to her is Nixon. And throughout the dinner, she kept her eyes completely closed. All through the dinner, she kept her eyes closed. And Nixon was getting more and more agitated, you know, saying, why is she keeping her eyes completely closed? And he kept asking her questions. And she kept her eyes closed. She would answer the question and go back to keeping her eyes completely closed. And after the dinner, one of her aides asked her that, you know, what were you doing this formal dinner? I mean, you know, you're sitting out there, everybody's looking at you. Why do you keep your eyes closed? She said, oh, but I had a headache. I had to keep my eyes closed because I had a terrible headache. And the next day, they held a press conference, and she completely flummoxed Nixon, because at the joint press conference where Nixon and she were speaking, every time she would ask a question, she would answer only in French. So Nixon didn't understand a word of what she was saying. Bangladesh had been liberated, and after the Bangladesh war, what happened then? Abhinav Chandi Durga. You know, Vajpayee called her Abhinav Chandi Durga, Shakti, Empress of India. She was called the Empress of India. So she was at the very zenith of power after the Bangladesh war. But sadly, within 3 years of that, she had declared the emergency and she had plummeted to the depths. But all through the Bangladesh war, it really was P.N. Haksar who was behind the war. And there was a very interesting anecdote was told to me by her doctor, who said that on the second day of the war, when war was raging, he went to meet her and he found her changing the bed cover in her drawing room. And when he asked her that, you know, madam, there's a war raging and you're changing bed covers. So she said, so what? Just because there's a war doesn't mean I can't have ironed bed covers. No. So that was the kind of...
No, closing this
topic on, we started talking about P.N. Haksar. There's just one little sentence which intrigued me. So though he was so efficient, as you say, there were a lot of people who criticized him as well. There's this comment saying, you know, the politicized bureaucrat was a constitutional aberration, they said. Yeah. So in spite of doing his best, he was also... criticized.
Oh, absolutely. I think, you know, the creation of the committed bureaucracy, the committed judiciary, you know, Indira's bureaucrats had to be loyal to the Indira Gandhi revolution. They had to be loyal to the Indira Gandhi socio-economic revolution. So if you were not loyal, you couldn't function. So while Haksar was very much a very efficient, a very remarkable figure, yet he demanded loyalty. And I think this is the problem I have with Indira Gandhi's politics, that she created so much damage to India's institutions, you know, whether it was a civil service, whether it was the political system, whether it was the judiciary, whether it was corruption. She really dealt a mortal blow to many of India's very precious institutions, which had been so lovingly nurtured by her father.
Because of the influence of the coterie around her, by then Haksar had gone and the others had come in.
She encouraged a culture of sycophancy, which Nehru had fought so hard all his life to eliminate. And she created a coterie, and I think by the end, you know, by the time she declared the emergency, she had become so suspicious and so paranoid, you know, the Lady of Shalott caged in that tower, that the only person she could trust was her son.
Just closing this topic on the emergency, one final word. There's a lot of course, there's no one who will say the emergency was right. But there's also this sentence from your book which says, the emergency was an original sin, but those who tried to bring down an elected government through sheer public pressure weren't exactly democracy's ministering angels, which I thought was, you know, very good looking at it from the other side. I mean, you can't...
The emergency, I believe, dealt a body blow to Indian democracy. You know, it really finished off the roots of India. She hacked away at the roots of Indian democracy, which her father had tried so hard to put down. You know, the independence of the civil servants, the judiciary, the press, all of that. But on the other side, Jayaprakash Narayan was calling for a mutiny He was calling for a mutiny of the armed forces. He was calling for a mutiny of the police. He was saying that if, you know, when the government gives an order, you should refuse to carry out those orders. Now, the Indian system is based on the supremacy of the civilian, is based on the supremacy of civilian authority. So if you are saying that the military must not take civilian orders, then you're effectively paving the way for martial law.
Something like Pakistan.
Something like Pakistan. So her point was that if the army is being asked not to obey the civilian authority, then are we saying that the civilian authority is irrelevant? In which case, you know, in those days, we must remember, democracy was very fragile. It was very weak. She was only, democracy was just about 30 years old. And she was, according to herself, acting to prevent martial law. But of course, you know, my reading is she declared the emergency because she wanted to stay on in power. I mean, the Allahabad High Court judgment had come in. It had unseated her. And if Nehru had been around, I think he would have probably resigned. But she refused to resign. And in fact, you know, one of the, Mr. Siddharth Shankar Ray has written that Jagjivan Ram, the great stalwart of the Congress, had told her at the time that, Madam, if you want, you can resign, but please leave your successor to us. And that's when, you know, something, a hard glint came into her eye and she realized that, listen, I better not leave power because if I leave, I'll never be able to come back again. So she was that kind of ruthless politician who, you know, that's why I've called her the most powerful prime minister, because she pursued power with ruthless single-mindedness.
But also there is this contrast, you know, between politicians then and now. The period that she was not in power, I found it very difficult to believe that she lived so frugally.
Yeah.
I mean, we imagine her to be someone all-powerful, someone with limitless, you know, resources. Mm-hmm. But then you describe that very frugal meal she used to have, the very minimal resources.
She had nothing when she lost power. And she, you know, she declared emergency by law. I mean, now we have an undeclared emergency, which is not declared by law, but it's still an emergency. So she declared the emergency by law and she revoked the emergency. She submitted to the power of the vote. You know, so in that sense, and when she lost power, she lost everything. She had no house, she had no car, she had no money. She was living in Muhammad Yunus's home and she only lived off her father's royalties. But, you know, so when I asked Mr. Chidambaram, I had a Delhi launch of my book. And so I asked Mr. Chidambaram, because, you know, she lost power in 1977, but in 1980, in 2.5 years, she was back with a 2/3 majority. So having completely been wiped out in 1977, she was back in 1980 with a 2/3 majority. And I asked Mr. Chidambaram, I said, why didn't the Congress party learn from Indira Gandhi? You know, she was defeated so badly, but then within 2.5 years, she was back in power. So Mr. Chidambaram looked very forlorn and said that, oh, well, yeah, but she was up against Morarji Desai. Yeah, we're up against Mr. Modi. how can you compare the two?
Oh, we've run out of time totally, Sagarika. But this, if you permit me just one more minute, there's one thing troubling me about this book, which I thought, with your permission, if you allow me to say, you know, what I didn't like about the book also.
Yeah.
The kind of innuendos you've made about her relationships. Of course, we've read this earlier in M.O. Mathai's account, which I thought was very distasteful by itself. Uh-huh. You brought that in and also added a few of your own.
You know, I think when one is writing a biography in this way, one has to be warts and all, you know, and you have to bring in the relationships that are out there in the public domain. And I think there was nothing to be ashamed of.
So it was not for sensationalism.
No, I mean, she was a single woman. She was, you know, by then her husband had died and she had relationships. A couple of them were you know, as I've said about Mathai, we don't know. But we really don't know. But if she did have relationships, I think it's important that we accept that she was also a human being with a lot of, with, you know, and someone who believed in close relationships. But, you know, as I also quote Natwar Singh as saying, that it was impossible for her to have an affair because she had security men under her bed.
I think we have to close it here. But before that, if you were to write another biography, who would your subject be, Sagarika?
I'm not telling. It's on the anvil.
I think we have to close it here. One thing I'd like to add to what she's saying is that, you know, she's been pilloried for the emergency by everyone. She's been eulogized for the Bangladesh war. But for me, she'll be a heroine for, you know, what happened after the Bangladesh war, how she handled the refugee crisis.
Yes.
And how neatly she did it. Right now we are facing this, you know, from a tiny country like Syria, you can't accommodate them across Europe.
The Rohingyas.
Or the Rohingyas,
we are not, you know, we are not being able to take in the Rohingyas. Indira Gandhi absorbed 10 million Bangladeshis. You know, they were housed, they were rehabilitated, they were placed in camps, and then very smoothly they were sent back.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Sagarika, and thank you all.